Hey, everyone. Good evening and welcome. Thank you so much for being here for our session. My name is Sean Mays, and over on your other spotlighted screen is my dear friend and collaborator, Sarah Whitfield, who is currently in, I'm out of New York right now, and Sarah is over in the UK. And it's a great joy to be here this evening on behalf of Muse hosting us as well. We're going to be sharing some information tonight. We're lucky to have the next two sessions this week and a session next week as well, being able to just have some informal chat time, to be able to talk about the contributions of Black music directors specifically to musical theater, which is very, very cool. And especially on our session tonight, we're going to be talking about two very influential conductors, Joyce Brown and Margaret Harris. And this is particularly amazing this week, I think, and we'll be sharing some info with you. I'm kind of doing a bit of an introing this week, and we'll be jumping in and out, but Sarah will be leading a lot of this session next week, and I'll be leading a lot of the session next week, where we talk with some of our active Muse members who are featured in a chapter that I wrote as well. But this week, it's very, very cool. Sarah has found some awesome archival material. Sarah and I have recently written a book specifically about Black contribution on the British side to musical theater in the first half of the 20th century in Britain. And so we do a lot of archival digging, a lot of research in this realm. And it's been very, very cool to actually go back and do some work talking about these two, not only very influential Black conductors of the 20th century, but also as women too. And to see, just, you know, in putting it very frankly, how badass they both were. And talking about their legacy and talking about also some connections to some of our Muse membership, certainly as far as mentorship and the like as well, and continuing that conversation for all of us as a collective in terms of figuring out how we move forward in our industry and talking about this sort of work of recovery and how important it is. So on that note, I'm going to toss it over to Sarah to start off and help introduce. And yeah, great to see. Even we are small yet mighty. Please feel free to you know, come on video if you feel so moved, or to say hey, or to pop in with questions. We got some cool stuff lined up tonight, so it'd be.
I'm also trying to listen to you and be very kind of calm. Short about the fact that Damon Evans is here in the chat saying I've actually worked as Joyce Brown in Via Galactica, which is an amazing. There will be time for some questions.
Oh, cool. And
if you feel so inclined, Damon, it'd be amazing to hear from you. Thank you so much for the lovely welcome. I'm Sarah Whitfield. I'm a reader in musical theatre at the University of Wolverhampton over in the UK. And Sean and I have worked together over the last 4 years, 5 years in doing this kind of research. And we kind of got chatting a little bit about some of the women MDs that Sean is looking at for his upcoming book. And I sort of thought it's quite interesting because there doesn't seem to be very much about, let me work on sharing my screen for a little moment and remembering to share my sound. I am doing a little bit less of Zoom teaching right now. So it's slightly not as kind of immediately ready, which I'm kind of glad about in some ways. There we go. Anyone see that okay coming through? Sean is, yeah, fantastic. Okay, so in thinking a little bit about the work of Joyce Brown and Margaret Harris, the thing that really struck me about Joyce Brown is obviously there's this amazing article, the ESPN article that was featured by Muse and by Maestro a couple of years ago, but she still has no Wikipedia page. And when she died, there were still no obituaries for her in kind of national press, which is really quite extraordinary. And she, her contemporary, Margaret Harris, is a little bit better known, partly, I think, because she went on to do a lot more classical music work. And that there was just, frankly, there was more information and she was active until the 90s. But we're going to have a little bit of a look at some of the stuff that I found. So this is coming really from digitized newspaper records and kind of theatrical kind of things like Variety, things like Billboard. The thing that really struck me about both of these extraordinary women is just how many interviews with them there are and how much coverage there is of their work. So this is something that became really familiar to Sean and I when we were looking at the material in Britain from 1900 to 1950, that we thought what we'd find is like very rare traces, because we were kind of idiots. And what we actually found was an unbelievable amount of interviews, articles, film footage, and actually that's quite a lot of the things that we found and are really excited to share with you tonight. And in being able to kind of bring Joyce Brown's words to you, it's obviously a great privilege to do that, but I also want to think a little bit about what this kind of research throws up and what we might do right now to start to think about capturing, as we've already seen tonight, some of the living memories and heritage of their work on Broadway and beyond. So Joyce Brown's career really kind of is an extraordinary thing to cover. She was known in 1965, the New York Times was shocked to discover that a Broadway musical was being conducted by a woman, but she'd actually started her career working in the extraordinary Latin Quarter. And I have to say, this is the politest picture of the Latin Quarter nightclub that I could find to share with you in the 60s, which is clearly a little bit risque, a little bit kind of, but it also had venues in Vegas and had in Florida as well. So it really kind of was quite a well-known nightclub in terms of that link. And one of the things that Sean and I found, again, in terms of London, is this incredible relationship between nightclub musicians, which will not surprise any musicians in the room, and Broadway musicians and theatre musicians. And we absolutely see that here, that is absolutely where Joyce kind of trained. But we found some new stuff, and some of the things that are really exciting about the kind of research that I've done is being able to see where she started. So sorry, some of these pictures are not particularly high res, but I wanted to share them with you. Anyway, we found that she was a rehearsal pianist on Saratoga, which is, again, these are not shows that anyone has necessarily heard of, but she was also a rehearsal pianist on Bye Bye Birdie, and then became the tour conductor. And again, this kind of, I don't want to say pipeline, but this kind of practice of coming from Broadway, of arriving to Broadway from doing national tours, absolutely seems to be the case. And amazingly, it also seems that she was working on industrial musicals. So if you haven't seen Bathtubs Over Broadway, this is a great excuse to go and watch it, but there's no information, unfortunately, as to what she was doing. And again, it really raises an interesting possibility of those musicals being led by Black women conductors during the late 1950s and early 1960s. But it was Golden Boy with Sammy Davis Jr. where she really got her first Broadway job. And this was the job that was seen as the absolutely shocking, internationally written about event. And it is, again, it's the coverage that we found is really quite, it's obviously racist and racialized. There's a kind of tension between the way in which it is misogynoir, that it is absolutely puzzled at how a woman and a Black woman would have got this job and been able to do it. And we see in the interviews a kind of the endless resilience that's required to answer these questions that are not asked of men. But what I will say is, for kind of comparison, I look to see some of the white MDs working on Broadway to see if they had this level of coverage, and they absolutely didn't. So there's something really extraordinary about the interviews and the words, and I've just kind of kept a few quotes. Again, they're not super high res, I don't know if they've come through very well, but I just really wanted to keep them. She says, "I'm in a man's world for sure, but I'm doing a job and I'm doing it well. I'm respected and accepted, and that's that," she says, getting back to music. And there is constantly a sense in the interviews with Joyce Brown particularly that she doesn't really want to waste time. She's got 15 jobs on the go and she has to crack on to kind of get the work going. And what's interesting about Golden Boy is that she was very often shown, and again, international, I'm going to skip forward a little bit now, very often shown in this amazing picture. And there's a description of her at the end of Golden Boy, that people were gathered around her and were watching her conduct. And this is from another show, but I really love this moment that you see this is exactly what's going to happen, that people came and asked questions. People come up to me and say they've never seen a woman orchestra leader before and they want to know how I got started and everything else. Well, she got started, I know we kind of went via the nightclub theatres, but she got started in church music. So again, we see this really essential heritage of church music for Black musicians at this period. And she loved music and her family loved music, but jazz was forbidden in her house. She said, my parents were very strict. It was the devil's music to them. And she actually kind of stepped away a little bit from church music quite quickly after that. She trained at the Teachers College of Columbia in New York City, and then went to Juilliard, where she played piano, cello, viola, saxophone and trumpet, and said, I studied all the instruments in order to be able to orchestrate and compose. It's a little bit unclear as to how much Joyce Brown was able to compose in this period, or whether any of the music that she did compose survives. I really hope that it does. She said to an interview, Nora Taylor, that there's a deep well of composition in me and I'm ready to do it. And it's incredibly poignant to hear her talk about this idea that to be accepted as a composer was something that was very difficult at the time. The other thing that all of these newspaper interviews have thrown up are credits which aren't officially anywhere else. So things which didn't particularly run for very long, or things where she seems to have been an associate, which just wasn't credited. And again, I know I'm talking to a lot of working musicians who will know that's how things are now. That's absolutely how things were then too. And sometimes Broadway is I'm about to say the sentence, Broadway is the worst, but Broadway was the worst at keeping accurate records of musicians. They may exist somewhere in an archive, but at the moment, in terms of how they were published, there just isn't that kind of information. But there is a little bit, and I'll get to what we're able to kind of know. And she went, so she obviously, her first huge show was Purlie, and that's the show that picture came from, with the people gathered around the pit. And that's one of the few places that we can actually hear her work as a conductor. So there is an original Broadway cast recording of that that's available on Spotify. If you haven't listened to it, it's an extraordinary musical event. And you can hear particularly the exit music is the music that was that people got up and sort of stopped the show. And she also unusually took a bow at certain points. And a lot of the coverage of Purlie features information about her and how she managed this Broadway pit band. And there is something about the way in which it's described as her show too, which is again something that I have not seen in other musicals being written about, that the music director, I know I'm talking to a lot of music directors here, you all know this very well, who are not necessarily featured or thought of in creative ways, but in this context she is absolutely being noted for the work that she's doing. One of the pieces of coverage she had talks about the very strong connection between Joyce Brown, the musicians, and the audience. And I think in terms of researching the history of the music director, there is so little coverage about what that job actually is, to see so much about Joyce Brown in terms of newspapers across the US and then beyond is really quite extraordinary. Sometimes we see that the coverage of her was very kind of mediated around the idea of her being maternal to her musicians too. And she obviously was incredibly caring and able to kind of get these very precise performances out of her musicians, but that's written about in ways that are very kind of fixated on the fact that she doesn't have children, but her musicians are kind of her children, so you do get a bit of that. She also had women musicians in her pit bands, which again doesn't seem to have been particularly common, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. It's just very hard to find who was playing in the pit at this period, this kind of mid-60s period. And she talked a little bit about what the actual experience of getting in front of these musicians was like. They respected my musicality. I told them, I know what I'm doing, and I'm sure you know what you're doing. Let's do it. There is a very precise, we are getting this show played throughout all of her discussions. And I'm really, again, that you can see here, the cast calls me Mama. You see a lot of this in interviews with her and in syndicated interviews with her. So again, this is published across almost every state in the US has something about Joyce Brown. She absolutely was featured in daily newspapers. And again, we see lots of different pictures of her conducting, and it's very difficult to find comparative images, particularly of women at work. So the idea of an MD at work, but what we're getting here is so many pictures of the way that she's working. And these pictures, again, were not rare. She was incredibly well known at the time. And I really want to emphasize that, because I think it's very easy to think about, oh, well, she was forgotten because, you know, there wasn't very much about it, but that absolutely isn't the case. She was so well known. She was so extensively talked about in terms of her contribution. And yet it just seems to have been purposely erased in terms of this accidental laziness that has particularly written out a Black woman conductor out of the way that we talk about the history of the musical.
It's very interesting too, just to like kind of keep putting this into context for all of us thinking about this, and particularly about just that, right? Erasure and thinking about, you know, how the people, how you know, it's so important to make sure that these positions of leadership are, you know, have a multiplicity in terms of definition and identity, right? Linda Twine, who many of us know, who, you know, of course, last year when we did this series, one session with her and one session with Harold Wheeler, and Linda Twine, who was the original conductor of Color Purple back in the early 2000s, Linda talks very specifically about Joyce. She always used to say Dr. Brown, and she talked, Purlie was one of the first shows that Linda went to see. And Linda was like, you know, she went and very much the same sort of background, right? Was teaching in schools and went to see the show and saw Joyce Brown conducting and said, oh, geez, this is something that I might be able to do, and talks about it. And it's really, really cool. So it's interesting just to like throw that back into the space as well. You know, we're talking about lineage here, right? Always talking about that lineage. And Linda says the exact same thing. She says that, you know, she was identified as the mother hen, right? Is how they would talk, how people would talk about Joyce as well. So just to bring that up in terms of people who are still in our circle, in our midst, right? And realizing what that lineage is.
There's kind of an odd thing about the way in which that overwrites some of the very clear professional changes that are brought about as a result of Joyce Brown's work. So she goes on to work. She doesn't do a great deal more on Broadway. And I think that is a kind of, there are other pieces. She does a lot of national tours for things, but she then doesn't bring those things into Broadway. There's another amount of work that she does in at the arena stage. I suddenly panicked about my names of American theatres, but please forgive me, it is 20 past 11 where I am, so my brain suddenly just had a bit of a moment. But she has a lot of vocal arrangements for things, really intriguing, the Mickey Grant opera / musical Alice. But it really, her kind of work, she does have this connection with Via Galactica, which I can't wait to hear Darren talk about. And then she comes back, she's associate in 1975 on Dr. Jazz, and then the first in 1981, which she also vocal arranges. And she does do some classical conduction, but she moves on to working with Alvin Ailey's company. And what she does there is introduce live music. So he had previously been working with backing tracks, and then she acts as a conductor, but there is very little written about her other than the sort of odd credits through it. She also worked on Pajama Game and again received the same amount of coverage for that. There's a really interesting interview article here. I don't know how well it's coming across, but it talks about her being stage door. So you have Cab Calloway, but then who's that woman there? That's Joyce Brown. And people knew who she was when they were at the stage door. And again, I think that's a real kind of testament to just how well known she was within not just the theatre community, but the theatre-going community as well during the 1970s. And again, I think it's so devastating that there is so little memorial of her work and so little testament to what she actually achieved. It's one of the things I'd like to come back to. But being able to search her throws up all kinds of new information. So, for example, this is a survey that was done and published in the Afro-American newspaper. And it was about which, sorry, I'm panicking that I've not panicking, it's a moment, I'll breathe. I've got two computers, which is one computer too many for this time of the evening. Let me just find where I am. I am here, thank you. No, it was in the New York Amsterdam News. And it was a collection that was published about black musicians that were working in Broadway pit bands that previous season on Broadway. And what's remarkable about this is, it's, as I said, it's so hard to find who was playing in these pit bands. But because we know Joyce Brown's work, we're able to start to think about the community of musicians that she was working with at the time. And because many of these musicians, obviously, you, some of them immediately you will know, worked across different kinds of music, particularly jazz. They were incredibly well known afterwards. So we were able to, I believe Warren Smith is still alive, able to kind of find photos and bring that sense of who was actually in these pit bands on Broadway in 1959 to 1960. And I think it's really important that even though we have very little extra information about what the experience of that was, we do point to it and know that it existed. The other thing to add is that there are incredible journalists, so particularly Elle Calloway, who wrote across nationally syndicated newspapers, but particularly in Chicago, about the role of black conductors and particularly black musicians in musical theatre and classical music. But his coverage means that a lot of this is refindable. So he wrote about it so much that we're able to kind of see, to have these interviews, to have these moments where we can bring these back. So she talked about this idea that if you're going to be a musician at all, especially a leader, you should involve yourself in everything musical. You should know every facet of the orchestra pit. My years of working in the pit and being a leader have really been an education for me. She was extraordinary. And I know we're rattling through the kinds of histories of two extraordinary women who we could have spent many hours talking about, but just to say that Joyce Brown died in 2015. And as I mentioned at the beginning, there are no obituaries of her published at the time that I found. It seems that she passed without any memorial at that time. Margaret Harris was, again, an extraordinary conductor who conducted across Broadway and classical music too. And there are many extraordinary pictures, and we found, and I'm really excited to share with you some film footage of her. So in 1947, aged only three, Margaret Harris launched her professional career in Chicago. And amazingly, an hour before we started this, I've actually found some footage of it. So there's no sound here at the beginning. Is it coming through? Can you see it? Okay, sure. Great. And what I really love is it's her with her family. So we get to see how proud her parents are. The sound is very poor on the recording. She's looking back at her mother, who was in the wings with her at that performance. I don't think that's been seen before tonight. It's been stuck in the Pathé archive. I don't think we've connected it to Margaret Harris's story before. But I've just done a little clip from you from the Dundee Evening Telegraph, which Sean knows is weirdly a really important source of black musicians. We just can't stop coming across it. But yeah, it was published very widely internationally in Australia as well. And Margaret Harris, after this, after she had made her debut, aged only three, clearly, very early television market thought, there's something here. She was offered, her parents were offered $13,000 to have her be on TV, and they turned it down. And she says, this girl had more important things to do, like go to school. So she went to train, which is extraordinary, and had the work of her parents here. She did perform again, aged 12. With the Chicago Symphony Orchestra and played the first movement of Mozart's D minor piano concert. She then went to train, and her family suffered incredible financial hardship to allow that to happen. She said, we lived on breadcrumbs. It's no BS story. Margaret didn't swear, let's be very precise. We'd put hot water on them and make pudding or cereal all week, but we all wanted something. We had a dream. She gained a scholarship to pursue her studies at Juilliard, and then she didn't just seek training in piano either. She went on to take conducting courses because she felt that it was important that she knew what the orchestra was doing while she played her part in the concerto. And it was as a pianist that she was booked to work with Donald McHale. But actually on the plane over to Britain, where they were appearing in 1967 at the Edinburgh International Festival, the conductor quit. So on the plane was told, by the way, you're going to be conducting this. It also means that she was conducting in the West End aged 23 at the time that she was doing this. There's something here that's quite interesting about the relationship with Dorothea Freitag as an orchestrator, but again, I don't know too much more about that at the moment. But she worked repeatedly with Donald McHale, and I think these networks of Black musicians and practitioners are really important and something that we might need to quite quickly start to map out and think about. She was phenomenally famous. So though Joyce Brown was widely written about, Margaret Harris was written about in a way, there are so many photos I have not included anywhere near even half of what I found here, and lots of beautiful kind of press shoots as well for her to be. She described herself as the Fuller Brush Lady, which is a door-to-door salesman advert. I'll get my foot in the door and hope they like the product. And she sometimes talks about herself and Joyce Brown as having one foot each in the door to try and create this work. She also worked with Cy Coleman, and he seems to have had a relationship, professional relationship with her and Joyce Brown too. But again, it's quite hard at the moment to know much more about that. She also worked, had a long relationship in off-Broadway theatre. And again, what's fascinating about this is these kinds of off-Broadway theatre shows list their musicians, they value their musicians. So unlike Broadway, we can actually see really clearly who it's playing. So again, we have Warren Smith, 10 years after West Side Story, and Harold Vick playing Reeves in this play that she was working as a music director for. And she does go on to have this quite extensive relationship with Joseph Papp and the New York Shakespeare Festival. They were also doing mobile productions at the time, so working across the five boroughs, taking different musicals across from essentially from small stages. And when she was doing that work, she was then picked up to go into her, and she was very, very reluctant to do it. She described that when she went in to see it, she was invited to go and see it, that it was a very young, you're supposed to have musicians right in front of you when you're conducting. And I was intimidated because it was Broadway and the young generation and a hit show and totally different from anything I'd done. I felt like I'd been hit by a gold-plated mallet. I didn't know it was gold-plated, it just hurt. I had called them up and said, I can't do this. They told me to come back and see what I think. So she decided to do a 2-week cover period working with an all-male band, all of whom were much older than she was. She described her original reluctance. My first day conducting and playing piano, I had a substitute drummer who didn't know the show. He was looking at me for tempos. I thought, if I can do this, I can do anything. And she went on to conduct over 800 performances of her, both on Broadway and across the US. So she was responsible for it doesn't seem to have quite been called a music supervisor role. She was essentially a music director for all of the productions and would fly across the states to fix problems where they were emerging. And what's interesting about that is while she has no credit on it, it seems that Joyce Brown also had a role with her in terms of teaching the performers who had no musical training how to manage the melody. But again, there is no credit for this, there is no information for this other than these interviews which we have found. While she was doing her, she had her first grown-up classical recital, which was very widely reported because obviously her was still such a shocking show 2 years, 3 years afterwards. And we know, I found these tantalizing kind of just tiny bits about her she does have a Wikipedia page unlike Joyce Brown, but things which haven't really been written about at all, that she'd written her own rock musical called Toy Girl. But again, it's very difficult to find if the music exists or if it was anywhere. And she went on to MD Two Gentlemen of Verona. And again, this incredible picture of her, age only 28, conducting this piece of work. And she, around this time, formed a talent agency, which I think is really significant, that what you see really, really quickly with Black women musicians at this period is how are they going to help the next generation up. So she kind of forms that. As soon as she's working on these musicals, she also starts to conduct classical orchestras as well. And again, the world of classical music being what it is, this is seen as incredibly shocking, and again, it's hugely widely written about and leads to even more articles about what she's doing. And this extraordinary headline, musical director protests through excellence. I think if you need a line of merch, that would be the one to go for. And this is an incredible picture of her conducting one of the Grant Park summer concerts. So she, and there were a lot of children there, and she wanted to make sure that it would be a moment where children from the Chicago area would be able to feel some sense of ambition in their own musical life. But she also worked at the same, a little bit later, in Hollywood, in this incredibly sort of odd feminist piece of TV that was a pitch for something, shockingly, was never renewed in 1973. And again, about 2 hours ago, I found footage of it. Now, there's a fleeting image of Margaret Harris conducting, which as I think is possibly the only image of her conducting that we have. This is quite bonkers. Just settle in for some 1973 spectacular, and I'll tell you when she's about to come up because it's blinking.
Tonight, The Shape of Things, starring in alphabetical order, Phyllis Diller, Lee Grant,
Okay, she's about to come up now. I would play the very strange song, but we unfortunately don't have very much time, so I think I'll leave that to your own devices. What you need to know is things get a lot stranger from there on in. Get past, yeah, so this is a the talent association that she formed. Now again, what's really intriguing about this, and if someone can find out whether it's true or not, I can't find any other credits for it, but it says that she also wrote some Promises and Coco as a co-musical director, but again, I can't find any extra information on that at all. It's just a kind of intriguing thing. And I wanted to kind of note that the way that she was written about, the way that she was respected as a conductor, and again, internationally known and discussed, is not a one-off. It's not it's not a kind of rarity. She was a celebrity on Broadway. Yeah, I have many, many histories of Broadway music just over here that do not feature her work. And I think it's really important that we start to think about what is being lost, because we don't understand what these specific, you obviously do understand, but in terms of the people writing these books, in terms of the general theatre going people, don't actually understand the difference between some of these roles and the significance of what was being done. Sorry, I just realised I've very awkwardly run out of water. there we go. And this final weird thing that I found again today, I promise I did prepare before today started, is that, sorry, I have long COVID, which is why this is happening, that she wrote the theme tune for the National Football League in 1974, which we think we found, but we can't actually say for sure is her music, but I think hopefully we'll be able to find out a little bit more about that. And this, for Sean's Canadian self, is there from Ottawa. She went on to Amen Corner. And this seems to be Margaret Harris's final Broadway piece. It may well not have been. It's her final credited piece. And you'll all know who's in the picture, who was her associate musical director. And I think it will be really important and fascinating to actually ask Miss Juber what the experience of working with her was, how those rehearsals were run. Because again, this is information that simply isn't written down or recorded, and we're starting to miss the chance to be able to kind of get it. So these are the questions that I want to chuck into the discussion and to take from here. that apparently a lot of coughing is going on at the same time, which is how can we preserve and collect the work that Black women musicians did on Broadway before it disappears? And what kind of knowledge about the professional contributions of Black musicians more generally is at risk of being lost, and how can we capture it? I just found today this remarkable clip of Juanita Hall at the strike. There was a strike because she was fired from a project as music director, and there was protests about it. Again, nothing is known about this or discussed about this. There are so many stories that we still need to get to. And Juanita Hall, this article's from 1937. The stuff that we've been looking at today is 1960s, 1970s, 1980s. It's so recent and yet in such danger of being lost. Sean, can you pick up while I get some water?
Yeah, absolutely. And just to also call in as well, how cool it is to think about, you know, Joubert having been also mentored, he talks about this as well, having been mentored by Margaret Harris, right? And so again, calling just back into the room, this is, you know, this is really the work of lineage. And this the session that I will be leading more next week, in sort of reverse with Sarah and I, doing these two sessions together, as you see in this graphic as well, Reframing the Musical, which is a book that Sarah edited, which I did a chapter in, features a chapter specifically about recentering the work of the music director and talking about, you know, some of these things that we've brought up today, right? What do we lose when we don't focus on making sure that this work is cataloged properly, that we don't talk about? And specifically in that chapter, the reason why that chapter, one of the central points for writing that chapter from my end was an article that specifically talked about the first time that four Black conductors were featured on Broadway. And one of those people was indeed Joubert as well. So just a cool way to kind of bring it back together and say, you know, we are, it is a question of looking at this legacy. And then particularly, you know, when we look at this work of recentering the work of women conductors as well, which is so crucial. So thank you, and thanks Sarah, thank you so much for leading us through that as well. It's so amazing as well to see all of this, and it's been a journey to get to see all of this as well, and it's cool to be able to share it with everyone, all of us here. I'm wondering if it's a potentially good time to open it up, and I see to Mr. Evans as well, as far as a question that we might have. But yeah, we'd love to invite folks, if you feel moved, don't be pressured to, but if you're so moved, if you want to turn on your video, feel free to, but even just to unmute and let us know either via voice or via the chat, if you have any questions or anything you'd like to contribute, it would be great to open up for discussion from this point. And Damon, maybe we can start with you, if you're, are you there and available?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, right on.
Okay, good. About Joyce, Via Galactica, first of all, we did not, it was one of the first through composed musicals on Broadway in the early 70s. We did not know it was going to be all music until 2 weeks before rehearsal began. We were given a script, and then we got a call through our agent saying, oh, by the way, we're gonna sing the whole thing. I'll never forget Joyce. I love Joyce. She was warm, meticulous in her work. And I'll never forget one day, I'm at the Chinese restaurant with my boyfriend after the rehearsal, and she walks in. It was a rough day, and she said, you know, it's a lot being the first. And the weariness of being the first woman, the first Black woman, the pressure. She just sort of said it, you know, had a drink and sent a drink over to us. But that human side, that vulnerable side that she shared with us, I knew she did Golden Boy. I knew of Margaret. I didn't know her personally. I knew she was in Hair. I got my union card through Hair. I didn't know about her classical background. These were the two trailblazers at the time. There just weren't, I mean, they were trailblazers in every sense of the word. And I think there was an element of Joyce when she said the first, it was like the freak. I think there was an element of freakdom about it that kind of was heavy, you know. And, but she was good at what she did. God knows she was. And I never understood what the connection was between her and Galt McDermott, but probably earlier when she did Hair or whatever. But she was very loved and respected.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Damon. Thank you. That's really amazing. And yeah, just to kind of touch on one thing that you said, which is, I mean, what a profound statement, right? It's tough being the first. And I think that just to sort of expand this back into discussion for the group is that, you know, again, with a lot of the work that Sarah and I have done, it's this notion of the first usually having happened a lot later than it actually is, right? So we find in many, many moments of sort of this recovery work and saying, oh, this is the first, you know, or people would talk about, I mean, there are academic texts written by, you know, Harvard musicologists that proclaim like the first Black conductor of a Broadway musical was X date. And it's just not even close to being the case, right? And so all that to say is that even just in terms of, you know, aside from even just trying to figure out what those specifics are, is that, you know, the point is that, you know, that these histories and knowing who these people are and making that conscious is so important so that other, you know, when we have pretty, you know, more women, Black, you know, Black women conductors doing this on these blocks here in New York, you know, and everywhere, you know, that they never have to open a book or they never have to go to something again and say, oh, am I the first person to do this? Or who was, or, you know, or actually able to retrace as far back as possible, right? That's a huge burden, right? That's a huge burden to have to carry to think that is unique, right? Which is, yeah, so thank you. That's a very, very amazing thing to share as a firsthand account of that.
I'm curious, did you reach out to Joubert? I mean, you could have gotten him on Facebook. I'm sure he would have loved to have been here.
Well, he's going to be with the, I'm leading the session next week.
Okay.
And he's going to be on with us next week. So he'll, we'll put him in the hot seat then about it as well. But, and he has spoken, yeah.
Thank you for doing this because Joyce and Margaret have been forgotten. Thank you for doing it. They were trailblazers.
Yeah, amen. Amen on that. And, hey,
Zane. John?
Hey, and Daryl, yeah.
Yes, and Sarah, I just have a question. So in your research, were you able to find information on these two remarkable women in kind of mainstream musical theater books at all?
No. So there's some very important work that happens on Black conductors and Black classical music. The crossover from there to musical theater research and scholarship is very poor. And I think that is very revealing of an assumption that it just couldn't have been the case. And of course, that's a hugely racialized assumption. But I think it's also unpicking the sort of an unwillingness to unpick that once you start to pull on this thread, everything falls apart so quickly. And I'm really passionate, and I hope that comes across in thinking about what do we do now? So the remarkable thing that we just heard from Damon, which is such a privilege to have heard, that those moments have to be recorded and have to be, because this history, particularly of Black women musicians, I think beyond that of music directors, particularly about Black music directors, has just been pushed to one side. And that's how Sean and I first started working together. We're starting to look at this, this removal basically from musical theatre studies. Would you agree, Sean?
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you know, and even again, like as far as Joyce Brown is concerned, like, you know, there was that one, I say well-known, I mean, you know, which is not, again, it certainly isn't, but as far as the ESPN article that was written on her, and, you know, even in terms of my specific academic work and diving into some of these folks too, right? Like it was really, it's really a lot of digging to get.
I just realized there's one exception, Sean, which is Donatella Galella, who is an extraordinary researcher. Mm. Right, the book on the has just recently published on the arena. Is it called the Arena Theatre? I feel like I'm making it up now, but it is nearly midnight. Big theatre, very important theatre.
Arena State, down in DC.
Yes, in DC.
Arena Stage.
So, Joyce Brown's work there does feature in Donatella's book, and one of the things that she's looked at is how, unfortunately, I wasn't able to get a copy of it for this evening. How she put out adverts for Black musicians in the local area for doing Raisin. But right. Something clearly happened in the production process of that, because she didn't come to the Broadway production. Like everything else in these things, there's always a story. But yeah, that's the only exception to the to where these histories have been properly recorded, I would say, so far, yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, that sort of work, you know, I mean, it's again, I talk about this and we'll talk about this in a bit more detail next week too, but, you know, it's sort of like this funnel of how, you know, it's hard enough even in our circles as musicians, right? You know, in terms of how that work gets cataloged, recorded and documented properly in terms of process and just the holes that exist in that, really, right? And then automatically when you layer on the additional levels of interacting with that as, you know, when you, like, for instance, in the instance of, you know, being Black or being a woman, right, in these sorts of circles, it's automatically going to become, it's going to become a little bit more difficult and even less talked about, right? So it's big work. It's big recovery work as well, right? But even just the interest of it alone, you know, is huge, right? At a large level, and keeping all these conversations alive.
The thing that certainly we've picked up in the, so we purposely chose a very early period, and there's a couple of things in British musical theatre history, which obviously features the work a lot of Americans, is that in some ways, it's as hard finding this material in the 1970s and the 1980s as it was finding material from the 1910s and the 1920s. And that means something is very wrong about the way in which the history of the Broadway musical has been told. But the other thing to just throw in there is that these stories, so when we think of Margaret Harris coming to the UK in the 60s as an MD, there had already been Black women MDs. The earliest we have found, it will not be the earliest, is 1917. And Mabel Mercer, who we know is a cabaret performer, was also an MD on a show that toured for a period of 5 years. So I think there is just as much missing work around Broadway and touring theatre as there was in the UK.
And on both sides, right? Like Sarah and I have found remarkable photos that are not dissimilar in any capacity to, you know, the photo of like, Joyce standing in front of an entire pit of white men, right? And the further back you go, obviously, the more that would have been the case. But you know, there's incredible photos that we've got. Some of, you know,
Light of Snow
is an instance of one conductor who is on, you know, again, looking at this on the British side, you know, picture of her standing and holding a baton, standing in front of, you know, again, largely and especially all men, right? As a base point of starting in terms of what's problematic, but you know, of course, further to that. So yeah, but interesting as well. Thanks for sharing that again, Damon, too, as that jumping off point. I'm wondering if there are any other questions from anyone who's been on or hearing anything that intrigues that Paula, not to call you out into the room, but I see you're here, and I see you mentioning about copies of the program and playbill with Purlie as well, which is very cool. I have a feeling some other of our members, Zane, that might be, I know you got one of those sitting in the studio at home or not, but very cool. Very cool to do some digging on all of this as well. So thank you for that offer. Does anyone else have any thoughts or any questions before we call, as far as the evening is concerned?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're coming through, Paula.
Okay. I find this is incredible, between the images and the music clips that you found and everything like that. And this, none of this is in any history. And I've not seen this when I've done research at Lincoln Center or the Schomburg. This is not in any of those places. So this is incredible. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, Paula.
And the other thing I want to kind of throw into the space as well is my special skill is finding stuff. And I think if there are musicians and in particular women musicians where you think, do you know what, I've never read much about her, but I'm aware of her, please do, either to Muse or to me, let me know, because we really would like to make sure that we try and access and build these stories. And there will be, I think we will be putting an article on both Margaret Harris and Joyce Brown as two blog posts up on the Muse website. And I'll make sure that it embeds all of these links so that they can be as widely shared as possible.
Okay, before you go, there's one thing I want to say about Via Galactica. It was the very first show to open what is now the Gershwin Theater on Broadway. But originally the name of the theater was URIS, URIS. And the name of Via Galactica was originally called UP, but they changed it because they didn't want the marquee to read UP URIS. So they changed it to be a Galactica.
That's amazing. That is some incredible bit of information, Damon.
And on that note, I know.
Sarah and Sean, I have to thank you so much for this incredible, I mean, this is absolutely astonishing. And I can't wait to be able to like share this, this whole recording and get, you know, and Maestra, I'm sure, will do the same as far as sharing it as well, which is, I just feel like it's just more people need to know about this. It's fascinating because, you know, with the advent of even in the last several years of that IBDB website, which is, which all of a sudden is starting to like go back and document, you know, who, you know, people that were in shows and worked on shows. And truly there's still, you know, thinking back to even, you know, in the 50s and 60s, there are so many pianists and arrangers and people that just never got credited for all the work they did on huge musicals like West Side Story and Gypsy and all these things, so that was never like, I always knew that, but for someone so incredibly like, you know, for women like that were so widely written about, mm-hmm. for it to just be kind of erased is just so shocking to me. You know what I mean? And it's so wonderful that you dug up such incredible footage and information about it. I hope there are many more musicians, both women and men, and certainly Black musicians on Broadway, because, you know, we all know that as far as the history of Broadway has been a very white male history, and in the British tradition as well, even more so. So thank you so much for this incredible, incredibly enlightening afternoon or evening. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Right on. Thanks. Thanks again, Sarah. Just to mention again into the room, next week we're going to be having another event as well with at least three of our founding members invited as well, discussing the role of the music director. And especially as far as that contribution as Black music directors and exploring that in more detail. I'll be taking the lead on that. And that's a half an hour earlier. So that's at 5:30 next week to mark your calendars, as well as opposed to 6 Eastern. But thank you all so much for joining us again, small yet mighty, and wonderful to be able to continue these conversations. And keep doing the digging, keep doing the research as well. Thank you very much, and have a great rest of your evening.